Are you more of like a honk shoo, or more of like a me, 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 me? It's an important question. No, it's actually a trick question, because either way, if you sound like that when you sleep, you might be at risk of having obstructive sleep apnea. You thought it was fun, but it's not, because in addition to loud and irritating snoring, it can come with some real health risks. And the current standard of care is a machine called a CPAP. It works by using pressurized air to keep your breathing consistent while you sleep. These machines are expensive, and people don't like using them, but at least the quality of the clinical evidence for them is poor. Wait, what? Grab your old-timey nightcap and candle, because like many things in science, it's complicated. Obstructive sleep apnea, or OSA, affects around 1 billion people worldwide. It's a condition in which your throat muscles relax too much in your sleep and block your airways, causing you to stop and start breathing several times throughout the night. Besides all the problems that come with getting poor quality sleep, untreated OSA has been linked to complications such as cardiovascular events and high blood pressure, and it's associated with diabetes, too. CPAP, which stands for Continuous Positive Airway Pressure, is currently used as the standard of care to gently force your airways to stay open in your sleep. The treatment generally includes a mask to fit over your face, along with tubing and machinery to filter and pressurize the air. While they are the most common treatment, CPAP machines are not exactly a popular option. They can be uncomfortable and noisy, with enough issues to fill up whole web pages of tips on how to improve their fit and feel. The machines also run you on average $800 US without insurance, which doesn't include the ongoing need for replacement parts. So what with it costing you an arm and a leg, you probably want to be darn sure that this machine is actually able to fix all the health conditions it claims to. And that's what a review published in 2022 by the US Department of Health and Human Services set out to investigate. The team analyzed 52 publications to figure out whether CPAP is effective in reducing the long-term health effects of OSA. And they reported that there wasn't a ton of strong evidence to support CPAP machines actually leading to improvements in most of the outcomes they looked at. To be clear, they did not say that there is overwhelming evidence against CPAP machines. Rather, the studies were too contradictory or conflicting in their design to be able to say much of anything at all. The studies were inconsistent in their definitions of OSA and breathing measurements, even though there are published standards that could totally be used. Even some papers that cited the same source for their definitions didn't end up using the same criteria as another. Studies also did not properly address whether the benefits of CPAP differed based on the severity of the participant's OSA or other potential confounders. Overall, it may come as no surprise that the report recommended more research. Specifically, we need more high-quality studies to confirm the impact of CPAP, and we need to be clear on which patients would benefit most from using CPAP devices. Not everybody was happy about this report. Physicians feared that people would misinterpret the results to mean that CPAP machines definitively do not work, which could lead to insurance providers like Medicare refusing to pay for them. In fact, sleep doctors stand by CPAP machines as the gold standard treatment for OSA. And one reason might be that doctors look at the evidence a little differently than the report's authors. For example, the report only included studies that conducted follow-ups for physical outcomes after at least 12 months, and there weren't any such papers with enough statistical power to look at the effect of CPAP on high blood pressure. But in a meta-analysis published in 2024 that included studies with shorter follow-up times, researchers found that CPAP treatment was associated with reduced blood pressure in less than 3 months. In fact, you can dig up similar contradictions for nearly everything you could want to study about CPAP and OSA. Which is to say, you can. And we did. When we tried to research exactly what long-term health conditions are definitively improved by using CPAP machines, we had, like, a really hard time finding much consensus. Even an outcome as fundamental as daytime sleepiness didn't yield consistent findings. One study in Australia included 31 participants who used their CPAP machines for an impressive 7 or more hours a night. 20% of those participants still did not come down to typical levels of daytime sleepiness, and more than half didn't reach typical levels of daily functioning due to sleepiness. On the other hand, research groups in India and Taiwan were able to find significant significant improvement in daytime sleepiness in their 34 and 47 participants, respectively. And while the research groups used the same questionnaire to evaluate sleepiness, their analysis methods were slightly different, which makes it still difficult to directly compare. So before we even get to stuff like cardiovascular disease, it's already incredibly hard to give one digestible answer to the question of whether CPAP works. Does it make you less sleepy? Yes or no? So what gives? Why is the golden child of obstructive sleep apnea treatment not showing us consistent results among study participants? Well, study design is one issue, but we also need to turn to the definitions of two terms, efficacy versus effectiveness, which sound the same. I know, maybe just one is like the pretentious older sibling of the other. But in the lingo of medical interventions, efficacy is basically how well a treatment does under perfect conditions, and effectiveness is how well it actually works in the real world. In the case of OSA, efficacy is the absolute ability of a CPAP machine to stop your airways from closing while you sleep. Effectiveness, on the other hand, takes into account both efficacy and how well people actually stick to using the machine as prescribed. And since we have established that CPAP machines can be hard to get used to, it may not be surprising that their effectiveness is a lot lower than their efficacy. Like what? You don't want to be attached to an uncomfortable face hugger all night? Get used to it. To count as being adherent to your CPAP machine prescription, you only need to be using it for at least 4 hours a night. Studies could be averaging the results of everyone who qualifies as adherent, whether they're using their CPAP machines for 4 hours or eight. And as Health and Human Services pointed out in their review, in most studies, a lot of participants didn't even clear the 4-hour bar. So the results between studies could have been inconsistent with each other due to inconsistent CPAP use. Let's look at one final health outcome to drive this point home. In that Health and Human Services report, they found that there was not enough significant evidence to say that CPAP can reduce cardiovascular events in patients with OSA. They looked at 12 studies to come to this conclusion, of which only two found a reduced risk of cardiovascular events with proper CPAP use. When looking at all 12 together, the authors concluded there wasn't strong enough evidence to say anything conclusive. Now, a different meta-analysis looked at three of those 12 studies, and by themselves, the three did not find any significant reduction in cardiovascular events due to CPAP use overall. Two of the three studies showed that there was no significant reduction in cardiovascular events, no matter if the participants were adherent to CPAP use or not. The other showed that there was a significant reduction in cardiovascular events, but only for the people who used their CPAP machines as prescribed. The meta-analysis took the individual data from each of the three studies and combined them all into one big group. This gave them an effectively new set of numbers to crunch, totaling more than 4,000 people, and they found that when comparing the groups as is, CPAP did not seem to have a significant impact. But when they isolated just the participants who used their CPAP machines for at least 4 hours a night, they were able to find a significant reduction in the risk of cardiac events. It's all in how you run the numbers. Relationships can appear and disappear depending on how you look at your data, so it is important to do your statistics properly and not just in the way that shows you that there's an effect. Here's the takeaway from all of that. It is well determined that CPAP machines are highly efficacious in preventing airways from collapsing throughout the night. But those benefits can disappear in studies of people out there in the real world being forgetful and imperfect and not flawlessly doctor order following as people tend to do. So an important question, are there any alternatives? One treatment option that I have not mentioned yet for reasons of dramatic tension are oral devices that reposition your tongue and jaw to keep your airways open. They look kind of like a mouth guard or a retainer. No tubes needed! It's officially called oral appliance therapy, or OAT, and while it may be less efficacious than a CPAP machine at preventing breathing obstruction throughout the night, it could be more effective since patients are more likely to be consistent with it. OAT is only meant for people with mild to moderate obstructive sleep apnea, but if you qualify and are having trouble sticking with a CPAP machine, this may be a great thing to ask your doctor about. Maintaining a CPAP machine regimen can be difficult for a lot of people. Studies suggest that only about 50% of people prescribed CPAP treatment are using it consistently enough, and that number could be even lower for people with milder sleep apnea symptoms. But people who use OAT instead of CPAP have been found to use their oral appliances for a whopping 95% of their sleep time. To fully assess the benefits of switching to OAT, doctors and patients would need to discuss whether the loss in efficacy is made up for by the increased consistency in using oral appliances. The full picture assessment is why some scientists are advocating for considering effectiveness instead of just efficacy when deciding on the best treatment. Another bonus is that while oral appliances may be initially more expensive than a CPAP machine, you only need to replace them every 5 years, whereas you might need to replace CPAP machine parts every 6 months. Analysis suggests that OAT matches the initial cost of CPAP machine after just 4 months of use. In terms of health outcomes beyond your beauty rest, some initial studies suggest that oral appliance therapy is comparable to using a CPAP machine for daytime sleepiness, blood pressure, and cardiovascular mortality rates. You know, to the extent that we know that for CPAP either. It's messy. One drawback is that the costs and coverage of oral appliances can vary a lot depending on the model you get, your insurance provider, and what region you're in. Also, if you have severe sleep apnea, oral appliance therapy likely will not work for you. Defer to your doctor on all of this stuff. I'm not a doctor. I'm not here to sell you on any of this stuff. Talk to them. So there you have it. The story of the CPAP machine is a complex one. Until researchers are able to conduct more conclusive studies on CPAP and OAT, it is hard to make any sweeping recommendations or conclusions about whether they're good or bad. We need higher quality, longer-term studies to be able to really understand what symptoms can and can't be fixed by different treatment options for obstructive sleep apnea. But I'll repeat what I said earlier, CPAP is still the gold standard, being the best option we have, and sleep doctors still want you to use it. If OAT works better for some people, awesome, sweet dreams. But do what your doctor says! And until researchers can hammer out a clearer consensus on CPAP, slap that boy on, get ready for a good night's sleep. If you're interested in learning even more about the science of sleep and how to help yourself do a better job of it, you might like this video that we have on the mouth taping trend. Does that work? I don't know. Head on over to find out, and thanks for watching.